You make no friends in the pits and you take no prisoners. 1 minute you're up $500,000 in soybeans and the next boom.
Do not attempt to adjust your device.
The revolution starts now.
We have to pass the bill so that you can find out what is in it.
Turn those machines back on!
You are about to enter the halls of justice.
Show me the money!
If we lose freedom here, there's no place to escape to. This is the last stand on earth.
This is the Halls of Justice. He is your host, Justice.
And welcome to the big show today, the Halls of Justice. I'm Justus on the phone with us. As always, it is the Fat Man. But before we get any further, I want to reach out. I want to say hi to a brand new listener. I want to say hi to our comrade in Russia. That's right. So part of the podcast is we have statistics that we could break down geographically as to where people have downloaded and listened to the episode. And last week it popped up that we had a listener in the Russian Federation is how it has it listed. So I tell you what, if you indeed are listening from Russia and you listened to the whole episode, it said, so you can understand English, I'm hoping. If you can understand English, you're listening to the episode, shoot us a private message of your phone number, and we'll put you on, and we'll talk to you for as long as you want to talk. We'll call on our nickel, and we'll talk to that listener in Russia. I think that'd be interesting. I think that'd be fun, and sometimes we need a little fun in our lives. So this week, it's the adventures of Fat Man as he continues his southward bound journey. Where are we broadcasting from today?
As you may have known, I said before the election that if Biden were to win the presidency, I was not going to do a Rosie O'Donnell and lie and fake and say I'm going to Canada if Trump wins. I said if Biden wins, I'm actually leaving the country, and today I crossed over into the Konk Republic, and I am coming to you live right now from beautiful Key West, the Konk Republic, an independent federation.
I'm jealous. Give me the weather update.
Right now, 74 degrees, a slight south-southwest breeze. And here's a visual for you. I'm sitting here scantily clad in a pair of shorts and a tank top with some salt on my margarita glass.
That's a little too
How
much
you doing?
Because I know that look. So
yeah, I may not make it back. I may not make it back north for a couple of reasons. One, because it's too gorgeous down here. And two, I may end up getting stopped at one of the multiple borders. Not like if I was trying to make it to the United States from Nicaragua, I would have no problem crossing. But if I'm going to try to get from the Konk Republic all the way back to home base, I might get stopped at multiple borders.
Well, you could always hop a boat, cut across the Gulf, and just take the long way home. Because join the caravan, brother, because you'll get in that way.
I get free health care and college if I do that, don't I?
I don't know. Oh, hey, I had a question for you. Maybe you can answer this, okay? Somebody asked me this today, and I'm like, I honestly have no idea. I'm going to have to ask somebody who's a little bit smarter than me on this. So,
and you come to me.
Right. How scary is that?
Big mistake.
So a president can only have two terms, right?
This is correct.
So what happens, hypothetically, if something were to happen to Biden and Harris takes over, does this count as a term, or could you theoretically be elected on your own two more times?
You have come to the right place. President Harris not only will spend at least the next 3 of the next 4 years as president of the United States, she will then be eligible to spend an additional 8 years as president of the United States.
I was really hoping
you
that
sound
was
like you passed a kidney stone.
I'd rather pass a kidney stone than potentially more than 8 years of this. That leads me to another point. So, yeah, it could happen. It'll probably happen. Write this down on your calendars now that we called it now. Is it's going to be more than 8 years of the Harris administration. So when Donald Trump, I don't know down there in the New Republic, if you can catch the news at all, but he gave a short little speech today. Part of it was his ending statement was, "We will be back." And people have been bantering around on the internet for a while. What does "we will be back" mean? Is it the Patriot Party? That seems to be the buzz. So if indeed he decides and is able to form this Patriot Party, the end game of it, does it just kill the Republicans' chances of ever holding office again? Because you're going to take your 70-some million voters, and that's not saying all of them would go to that party, but even if a third of them go there, and then you have a Democrat run, a Republican run, and this Patriot Party run, what happens there? What's the goal here? Because I don't see it doing anything other than fractioning and splitting the vote.
You have to remember, everything is very fresh right now. The election was just a couple of months ago. Biden was just sworn in. Harris hasn't even taken office yet. She hasn't even moved into the Oval Office yet. So there's a lot of changes going to come. A lot of the things you're hearing from President Trump or former President Trump, this stuff is all very fresh, and it's kind of reactionary. So the idea, it's being romanticized a bit, of Trump starting a third party, as fun as that idea might sound to some folks, the logistics and the practical aspect of that, it's almost impossible. As you mentioned, what'll probably happen is you're going to split maybe 50-50, maybe 60-40, something like that, the Republican Party. Trump will also pull some Democrats. He'll also pull some Libertarians into that. But if you take a full-fledged Democrat Party, and then you take a little bit of those two parties, the Democrat and the Libertarian Party, and then half of the Republican Party, and add that up, it's not going to be effective in fighting the Democrats. There's also a lot of money that has to be involved. So those two things are there. One, if he started it, because he wouldn't have the numbers for it to be an effective party, at least for, you know, who knows, maybe a decade or so, maybe even more than that, it wouldn't be effective in winning any elections. And then the financial backing of what you get out of the RNC, it just isn't feasible. Now, could it be something, I don't know, like a ghost party in essence, or something like maybe originally the Tea Party started out as, and there's still a Tea Party caucus, but to have that type of influence, I think so. I think that's more likely where it would go, where it would be referred to as, you know, the Tea Party caucus, or the, in this case, it would be the Patriot Party caucus, where they have influence over policy, but it really isn't somebody that you see on a presidential election. You see the Democrat, Republican, and the Patriot Party candidate. I just don't think the two-party system is too strong. And quite frankly, not only would he get pushback from Republicans, Democrats would also join in on that because they like the two-party system. And of course, the Democrats would be happy about a weakened party, but I think they're even happier if we just stick with a two-party system, because remember, there's only one big winner in the two-party system, and that's the two parties.
Right. Yeah. Well, that'll be something to watch in the months and in years coming up. We'll just keep an eye on that. So several executive orders were signed today, as promised. One was the travel ban, which numerous intel officers have already said we should keep this. But true to his word, Biden went ahead and signed the executive order undoing the travel ban. The other one was, not just the other one, one of the other ones was They have taken away the permits for the Keystone Pipeline. So pretty much all that did was piss off the Canadians and kiss China and OPEC's butt, as far as I can see. So those were two of the big ones. Thoughts on those today?
Well, you had to know when Biden came in, he was immediately going to do these things. And I would throw one other of those into the real big one, but you also knew it was coming, and that's the Paris Accord. He's going to put us back into that. But obviously, by losing the presidency, the Republican Party's platform and the way that the Trump was taking the country was going to come to an end. And these are the two of the big casualties for sure. That pipeline, I mean, and also part of the executive order on the pipeline that also stops the permits that were going to be issued or were issued for drilling in Alaska. And all of these things were keeping our fuel prices down. And it's because it's not just about what they're drilling now, it's what they're drilling in the future, and made this country energy independent, something that, you know, you and I are approximately the same age. That's something that you and I didn't grow up with, the thought of the United States being energy independent. And because of things like the pipeline, although, as you mentioned, it comes out of Canada and comes through the United States, it just made North America and specifically the United States, the world-class superpower in fossil fuels. And until we get something better, until we get a better delivery system, and until solar or sun or whatever you want to bring to the table, until those are more effective, fossil fuels is what we have. And by stopping that pipeline, by stopping the additional drilling, he not only weakens the oil industry, he weakens the economy, and he also potentially weakens us militarily. If you remember back to the Gulf Wars, one of the things that they were very concerned about was having to go into our crude reserves. You know, the country keeps a I don't know what the number is, but it's barrels of so many barrels of crude in reserves in case of national emergencies. And at one point, we were tapping into those reserves to try and moderate the market because of what they were doing in the Middle East and also with Russia, and how it was affecting fuel prices. And I'm sure you can remember four and in some states, $5 a gallon for gasoline. That specific executive order is taking us back down that path again. And, I for the life of me, I can't understand why the oil companies would have wanted Joe Biden back in, but apparently they did. And of course, the thing that they're claiming is it's bad for the environment. What about a pipeline was bad for the environment? Sure, they have. There are times when they have issues with pipelines or any of the other fuel systems that they, whether they're drilling in the Gulf or whatever. But pipelines are very safe, and apparently, Joe Biden thinks that the best thing for us to have is oil supplies from foreign nations. And I don't know why he would want us to have to rely more on countries like Russia and countries in the Middle East, but apparently that's what he wants. So we knew this stuff was coming. I don't think it's going to be good, but maybe 12 months from now we'll see it differently. We'll see what his way works out to be.
Well, let's mark this down. On today, January the 20th of 2021, gas is roughly in Ohio about $2.15 a gallon. So we'll see what it is next year and 4 years from now. And by the way, there are 43.8 billion barrels in the oil reserves. So 43.8.
Yeah, I thought it was 43.7.
Yeah, you were a little off.
I'm glad you checked that to make sure.
They bumped it up a little bit for you, just because they knew,
Well, they knew I got another gas guzzler, so.
Right. So we had to add another. Yeah. Okay.
Well, you know, one other thing on that, on fuel, one of the things you hear often from the left and sometimes on the right too, is the president doesn't affect gas prices. And in essence, that's true, but the president's policies can, you know, you know, we've had high prices under Republicans. We've had high prices under Democrats, and we've had low under both, both of those, you know, types of administrations as well. But when a president comes out and says, stop drilling, stop the oil supply, raises the cost of getting crude, that's going to affect your gas. So, you know, when people say, you know, the president doesn't affect, you know, cause, and this is a common thing that, that you hear people say, you know, the president doesn't affect gas prices. In essence, that's true. But in practice, it really isn't, because he sets policy that allows, you know, ExxonMobil to put, you know, the drill in the ground, drill, baby, drill. And if you can't drill, baby, drill, you, your cost of supply goes up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. $4 a gallon's coming back, guaranteed, almost guaranteed. And it trickles down, too, because you're going to eliminate jobs of people drilling for oil. You're going to eliminate jobs at the refinery. You're going to eliminate jobs on the pipeline, the truckers that get the finished product to the stations. You know, it's just going to have a trickle-down effect. Lots of people are going to lose their jobs over this, you know, over a signature on his paper.
I'm a big believer in vote your conscience, but if you have a career that is attached to coal, attached to oil, in any way, shape, or form, attached to fossil fuels, and you voted for Joe Biden, you should quit your job right now so that one of your coworkers who voted Trump can keep their job. Because when you voted for Biden, you signed your pink slip.
Yeah, yeah. And fracking will be next. He's already said it, so we'll see.
Absolutely.
So moving on, there's a freshman Republican U.S. representative from South Carolina. Her name is Nancy Mace. And all this week I was watching one after another as these Republicans are just turning on Trump. And proven to be a lot of times Republican in name only. She had a few choice words. Take a listen to this.
This was a traumatic event for many members of Congress, and I believe in the days, weeks, and months to come, as we learn more, the worse it's going to get. And we feared for our lives, many of us that day, and our staff. And as you know, my children were supposed to be up there. And if they had been there like they were supposed to be, I would have been devastated. And so we do need to find a way to hold the president accountable. And we're doing that in the press. And you're seeing corporations and companies say, not one more dime to those that objected. We're going to do the right thing. And so there are other measures that I'm encouraged by seeing out there. I want to be a new voice for the Republican Party. And that's one of the reasons I've spoken out so strongly against the president, against these QAnon conspiracy theorists that led us in a constitutional crisis. It's just wrong. And we got to put a stop to it.
Not one more dime for you. Fat man, you're a supporter of President Trump. Not one more dime for you. You no longer can get a bank loan for a car. You can't get a mortgage for a house. Not one more dime for you. We got to put a stop to it, to all this QAnon craziness. This is from a Republican.
There is so much to unpack in that statement and similar statements made by other people. First of all, to me, there is no difference between the U.S. Capitol and a neighborhood grocery store. If somebody attacked a neighborhood grocery store and burned it down, is that violence that much different than if somebody broke a window at the Capitol? To me, that's not. It's the same level of violence, but here's the difference. The violence came knocking at the door inside the bubble where these folks thought they were protected. It's about time, and first of all, before we get letters from Russia or China, let me say something we've said many times before. In no way do I support the violence that went on at the Capitol. I don't support the people who casually walked in past the Capitol police and were able to walk through the Capitol. Should never happen, and I certainly don't approve or endorse people who broke in to the building and went through windows. Any way, shape, or form, I'm not endorsing that at all. But it's about time these folks who sit inside this bubble, who sit up on the cloud and make decisions that affect them, us minions every single day, felt a little uncomfortable. Because it was okay when they were burning down Minneapolis. It was okay when they were burning down Portland. It was okay. Murders were up in New York. That's no problem. But all of a sudden, some that comes knocking to the U.S. Capitol, and now everybody's uncomfortable and everybody's aghast that how could this possibly happen? And I'm so tired of the rhetoric that's been attached to what happened there. Certainly there were some, and whether it was Antifa, whether it wasn't Antifa, doesn't matter. There were idiot radicals who went way too far in that crowd. No question about it. But I am so tired of this being classified as a coup, as an insurrection, or any of these other fancy schmancy words that you want to attach to it. This was idiots who went too far. There was no real possibility of the vote not being certified. Now, was it going to happen that day? Was it going to happen at 3 o'clock in the morning? Was it going to happen the next day at 2 o'clock? The vote was going to be certified, and Joe Biden was going to be certified to be the next president of the United States. So when was the last time you saw a coup or an insurrection that the leader of it was had a Viking helmet with two horns and a some kind of fur vest on or something, and nobody had any guns? Coups don't generally go down that way. Insurrections generally don't go down that way. So there was so much over-the-top rhetoric attached to what happened at the Capitol. Again, doesn't mean it wasn't horrible. Doesn't mean it wasn't wrong. Doesn't mean it wasn't a scar on our country. It was all of those things. But it wasn't a coup. It wasn't some massive attempt to overthrow the U.S. government. You don't come to, overthrow the U.S. government carrying a podium and a flagpole. That's not going to get it done. So all of this stuff that these people like Mace, all these things that they're saying, it doesn't carry any water. What all they're doing is taking an opportunity that was presented to them and pouncing on it right now. Because, and I've told you before, I didn't like Trump's words. It was January 6th. I didn't like his words that day. But this is the opportunity. So Trump's arrows on the way down. This is an opportunity to jump off of the Trump train, say, hey, I don't like that guy. I'm not attached to that guy at all. Here's the better way of doing it. And that's all they're doing, is taking advantage of an opportunity that's been laid out there. And it's so disingenuous and it's so over the top. And what they really don't realize is how much damage their words are doing. No one is trying to bring this country back together. No one is trying to heal. It's all about self-preservation and these folks trying to get reelected in 2 years or in 4 years or in 6 years, depending on their position. So honestly, the clip you just played disgusts me. And the clips that are similar to it by multiple people, also disgusting. And especially when it's aimed at their colleagues, because their colleagues did something that's been done many times before. Their colleagues had done what's been done many times before by the opposite party. So why are we talking about coups and insurrections and all this craziness when it was what it was? It was a riot by a few people that tarnished a peaceful protest by a lot of people.
But you can't object to the results of an election, right? Is that the point? Is that the point that Democrats are making?
I believe the Constitution would argue that point.
Right, but that's what the Democrats are saying. You can't object to the results of an election. But remember what happened on Donald Trump's inaugural day. Is there was another, I don't know, unpeaceful protest by people not wanting him to be the president. I don't know what to call him other than the he's not my president people. And it goes back even further. If y'all thought that just Donald Trump was a thorn in the side of the Democrats, it goes back even further. Let's go back and take a listen to this. Back from Bush when he was elected.
There'll be a big pothole on the road to the Bush inaugural. Rumors of a congressional challenge to the election results are picking up steam on the eve of the certification of the Electoral College numbers.
You say it's just a protest, but it does bring attention to the problem of our system when it comes to voting here in the United States.
We've got an electoral system out there that doesn't work. We spend more on prison food in this country than elections.
What they want to do, in part, is to highlight what they call the massive disenfranchisement, as Representative Conyers said in the letter that you just presented, of voters in Ohio.
So many voters were disenfranchised, they said, that the Ohio vote and the result of the presidential election are still in doubt.
The outcome, of course, was not changed, delayed less than 3 hours, though Republican leaders like Congressman DeLay and Ohio Republican Chair Bob Bennett treated it as if the Capitol had been pillaged by the Visigoths.
The Democrats knew that it was a pretty ceremonial objection, but regarded it as important.
Why did both sides treat this like political dynamite?
It would have been nice if both sides could get on a more bipartisan footing and look at these problems. I think Senator Boxer made an excellent point today when she said, we've got soldiers abroad dying for democracy, and we need to fix our own democracy here at home, and that's really what it's about.
And that was from Bush, too. So, you know, as long as the Democrats are doing it, it's good to go. But if you're a Republican and you question it even a little bit, then all of a sudden it is not good to go and you get labeled all sorts of nasty things right there.
I would love to be able to sit here and just lambaste the Democrat Party on the clips that you just played. But if we look back over the last 20 years, 50 years, go back as far as you want, there are so many hypocrites in our government. It should make all of our skin crawl. Just saying any of their names should send us running to the shower to clean ourselves after just thinking about some of these people that occupy office in Washington. If you go back and you look at some of the things that the Republicans said during the President Clinton impeachment, if you look back at what they said during the President Trump impeachment, total opposite. Then go back to look at what the Democrats said. And I'm not talking about the party. I'm talking about individual people. Go back and look what they said during the Democrats. Look what they said during the Clinton impeachment. And then look what they said during the Trump impeachment. Total opposite. So this is just another one of a long line of they say what is beneficial to them politically at the moment, not what they believe. Politicians don't play. That's not the currency that they use anymore. The currency being what they believe in. The currency is what is good for me to say right now. And here's the reason. They know the media is not going to fact check them. The media is not going to go back and look at what folks said 5 years ago in the exact same scenario, but when it would have benefited the other party. Or they're not going to go back 20 years and look at what folks said at that point because it would benefit the other party. And that's where the news media has got to come out. And that's where they got to come out and ask these U.S. representatives, these senators, presidents, vice presidents, you said this in 1997. Why is this different than what you're saying today? So go back in time and look at those clips that you just played. And if we go 10 years in the future and this same scenario comes up again, and it would benefit the other party if they changed their position, I guarantee you they'll flip-flop and change their position. It's just what they do. And it honestly, it's disgusting. And until the American people wake up and realize that's what's going on, and maybe this is what the Patriot Party can do, I don't know. But until the American people wake up and stop putting party over country, this is just going to continue. Say what benefits you right now. It's like when you know your mom comes home and you got your hand in the cookie jar and you got three Oreos stuffed in your mouth. Are you eating Oreos? No, I'm not eating any Oreos. I don't have any Oreos. I'm not eating any Oreos. And you just lie. You say what's beneficial to you, even caught with your hand in the cookie jar. I'm still going to stand there and say, because the most beneficial thing to me to say is I'm not eating any Oreos. So I'm going to say I'm not eating any Oreos. And that's where we're at right now. They just say whatever's convenient.
Yeah. And nobody checks them because they're all in bed together. Big tech, the media, everybody. So I got another, you're my constitutional law guy, my con law guy. Constitutionally,
constitutionally, can Washington, D.C. be a state?
Yes. And I need to go further.
Yes. What has to happen for that?
I think it's I'm not sure if it's 2/3 or 3/4 of Congress have to pass it. It's different than Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico is a because they're going to become a state as well. If this is where you're going, but Puerto Rico just they had the vote, and Puerto Rico, it passed in Puerto Rico that the people won it, and then it would go to a vote for them to become a state. But it's different for the for DC. I can't remember whether it was 2/3 or 3/4 would have to vote. But remember, what the fear is now that they've got a simple majority in the Senate with Harris being the quote 51st vote, that they'll take away that 60 vote majority that's there now on any bills being passed, and they'll take it down to a simple majority. So even if you have a situation where it's 2/3 or 3/4 or whatever it is, the Democrats may ultimately change that to a simple majority.
So here is, and my question to you was the deal, I know what you'll say, but was the deal already made? Was the deal already made? Here's the mayor of D.C. right here.
Yesterday, I was also heartened to see Washingtonians posting photos of their neighborhoods on social media and tagging them with We Are D.C. It is a much-needed reminder to the world that our city has so much to offer outside of the federal enclave. And actually, all of these neighborhoods are what will become the 51st state of Washington, D.C.
So was the deal struck long before?
Well, of course this is in the plan. I mean, you know, you can put the word deal in quotes, but of course this is something that's absolutely in the making. It's absolutely something on their radar because the two Senate seats that come along with it and the almost automatic, lockdown in the Senate. You add two more Senate seats to the Democratic Party, again, which would almost be guaranteed out of D.C. I couldn't imagine. It would take decades for a Republican to ever get a foothold in D.C. And then you add the same thing in Puerto Rico. That's four Senate seats. So right now you've got a 50-50 split with one, with the vice president being the 51st vote or the 101st vote. If you added four more Senate seats to the Democratic Party, there's no way that the Republican Party will get control of the Senate. So that's pretty much going to just allow the Democrat Party to any whim that they want installed into our government. It's just going to happen.
Oh, the music means we're at a break. What's coming up on the other side of this? You have to stick around. We'll be right back on the Halls of Justice.
Would you like to be a sponsor or advertise on the Halls of Justice? Email us today at hallsofjustice@roadrunner.com. That's Halls of Justice, spelled J-U-S-T-U-S, at roadrunner.com. If you have a show idea or like to be a guest, you can email us as well at hallsofjustice@roadrunner.com.
And we are back on the Halls of Justice. It's Justice and the Fat Man with you. Nice to have you along. And when we left off, we were talking about D.C. becoming the 51st state. I wanted to get to a few more things. So I guess the next topic on my thing here is, did you happen to hear the Katie Couric quote when she was on the Bill Maher show?
You know, I heard what the gist of the comment was, but I haven't heard the exact quote, and I would love to hear her words. As a matter of fact, hold on, let me scooch to the edge of my seat, because when Katie speaks, I get a tingly feeling up my leg, and I want to be in the proper position. Please proceed.
You have the whole seat, but you only need the edge. Take a listen.
Okay, and as much as I'm worried about
these loons who break into government. I'm actually more worried about the loons who did get elected. Because, I mean, what do you do about these people? There's 147 Republicans in Congress who still don't concede that Trump lost the election. What do you do about people who are in the government who don't believe in our way of government?
It is so shocking. Not only are they not conceding, Bill, but there's thoughts that there might have been some collusion among members of Congress. Some are refusing to go through magnometers or whatever you call them to check for weapons. They're not wearing masks during the siege. I mean, it's really bizarre, isn't it, when you think about how AWOL so many of these members of Congress have gotten. But I also think some of them are believing the garbage that they are being fed 24/7 on the internet by their constituents, and they bought into this big lie. And the question is, how are we going to really almost deprogram these people who have signed up for the cult of Trump?
Deprogram. I need deprogrammed. So what happens there? Do you go off to a camp? Is it a summer camp? Is it a day camp? Is it just a weekend thing where I'm in and I'm out? Do I have to get a tattoo? Says I'm deprogrammed before I can get into the store. Do I have to carry a card? What is deprogramming? And the one thing that isn't crazy is the fact that she no longer has a real job. So deprogramming, Rich, do you need deprogrammed?
I have one word for you. Wolverine!
It's exactly what I thought earlier. It was when I heard this, I'm like, oh my gosh, this is crazy.
That's scary enough when someone like Katie Couric says it, but she's not, and it's not just the word reprogrammed. It's also the word cult. I've heard this word used so many times, and actually both of them, and often together. AOC has said it. As you mentioned, Katie Couric has said it. Maxine Waters. They're all talking about, if you are a Trumper, you're beneath them. And this is where whether it's the Hollywood elite, whether it's the social elite, whether it's the governmental elite, the elite has always, and this was the appeal of Trump. A lot of times people were like, why was Trump such a big deal? Why was Trump such a big deal? Because he appealed to people across the masses. You know, as you know, I travel the country on a motorcycle, and you know, this isn't scientific, but I could be in the mountains of West Virginia and you see Trump banners. I could be in a suburb of Cleveland, and I'm not just talking about a few, I'm talking about an abundance of them. Suburbs of Cleveland, I saw them. Riding through the hotbed of Virginia, which is a blue state, riding through Delaware, nothing but Trump signs. And these are in clearly expensive homes. These are mobile homes in the middle of clearly lower income folks. He had mass appeal because he connected, and he didn't, even though he's a billionaire, he didn't give you that, I'm an elitist, I'm better than you. And that's where all of this comes from, this we need to reprogram. They're not as smart as us. They're not as developed as us. They're not as cultured as us. We need to make them like us. And the stuff with big tech and with members of Congress accusing other members of Congress being involved in a coup, members of Congress coming out and saying, I'm afraid that one of my colleagues is going to kill me. This all ties into this, we have to make them think better.
Yeah.
And this is the same kind of thing that happened after Pearl Harbor. It's another scar on our history, and every nation has scars, but this is a scar on our history when the Japanese were put in internment camps. And I'm not saying they're going to run off and try to put us in camps, but I would say this to you. There's people out there that would love to have that happen. And maybe not camps, but if you're a registered Republican and voted Trump, you need to show up for a two-hour class three times over the course of a month and get re-educated or reprogrammed. And that's really how they feel about us. And again, that's why Trump was so successful where he came from. He connected to those people who felt that everybody was always looking down their noses at them. And that person could be a janitor, a plumber, a welder, a car salesman, a real estate agent, a doctor, across the board. You didn't feel you were being lectured to. And if you listen to Katie Couric there, she's taken an elite position, and she's telling you, you Trumpers, how she's going to fix you, because you're broken. You need fixed, and she has the magic elixir that can fix you.
Yeah. So I think all the Democrats get a memo on what the catchwords need to be when they do interviews, because once one of them starts, they all start. The big thing this week has been white supremacist. So it wasn't protesters that broke into the Capitol building. 73 million voters for Trump weren't Trump supporters. Now they are all white supremacists, because by saying that, they can demonize everybody that supported Trump. They could use the worst names, the worst titles possible, one of them, and in an instant, they could demonize everybody who doesn't support their views. I've heard that numerous times, and I'm going to play something for you at the end here that really ties this in, but that's about 15, 20 minutes off. But just remember what I just said there, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So another one of their catchphrases that has popped up here in the last week was they need to hunt down all these Trump supporters that attack the Capitol, all these Trump supporters that are causing problems, just like we hunted down all the people that were responsible for 9/11. Because apparently now they've been tying in, if you're a Trump supporter, you're also on the same level as ISIS. You're on the same level as Al-Qaeda. So now the terrorism isn't abroad. It's now domestic terrorism if you don't support what they support. Take a listen.
There is strong interest in the Congress and the 9/11 type commission.
A deep look and a 9/11 style commission to really get to all of what happened.
Yeah, they need a 9/11 type commission of inquiry.
Along the lines of a 9/11 commission.
A 9/11 type commission.
And hopefully an independent 9/11 style commission will look at.
I think this is a big enough threat, an attack on the center of our democracy, that it's going to need a look that spans branches of government, something closer to a 9/11 commission.
So they all got the mass email. Hey, if you get on TV, I want you to say 9/11 type commission. We're going to start tying in Trump supporters into terrorists. That's how it's going to work. We're going to take it one step further than these people just don't share the same view as us. But now we're going to demonize them. We're going to criminalize them. If you supported Trump and you don't share our views, you're a terrorist. And you need to be hunted down like the 9/11 terrorists.
Well, we can point back to Maxine Waters being one of the starters of this type of movement that painted anyone, not only the Donald Trump or the Trump family, but anyone associated with him, including people that voted for him, painted people who fall into that category as uneducated. And it ties into what we just heard from Katie Couric as well. You have a situation where they feel that there is only one way of thinking, and you had better fall in line with that thinking. And if you don't, there's going to be hell to pay. And if they see you at a gas station or at a restaurant, they want you to get up in their face. President Obama also said a very similar comment. He wants you to confront Trumpers. Sarah Sanders wasn't allowed to go out and have dinner with her family because she was going to be confronted. Tucker Carlson, although not a Trumper, had people show up at his house. This can go on and on and on. And the funny thing is, the party of peace, the party of can't we all get along, the party of hugs and kisses, they're the ones preaching this violence. And now all of a sudden, they want us to fall in line behind Joe Biden, when for over 4 years, there was no way they were going to fall in line behind President Trump. And it's just, as I mentioned earlier in the program, it's just hurtful, non-beneficial rhetoric. There's nothing positive coming out of this kind of talk. And then the action that kind of talk brings on. You know, everybody's talking about January 6th and President Trump's words. And like I've said many times already, I didn't like some of the words he used in that speech. I like some of the words he used in some of his other speeches. But I can tell you, in my mind, the words that have been spoken by members of the Democratic Party riled up the people of that day of January 6th, those people that broke into the Capitol building. Those people were more inspired and more fired up by words spoken by the Democratic Party than any word Donald Trump has ever said. And they just don't see the errors in their ways. And they just don't think that we're smart enough to understand. We're not on their level. And that's why we just don't get it. And we're not capable. And the only way we're going to get there is if they can reprogram us.
Yeah. So do you think maybe in the master plan, the Democrats are hoping that somebody goes postal? Do you think that
I will tell you this? They were hoping something was going to happen at the inauguration. I guarantee you they were. There's no one more disappointed than members of the Democratic Party that something didn't happen today. Now that doesn't mean they wanted, you know, somebody to die, somebody to get injured. I'm certainly not saying that. But they certainly wanted basically stuff that happened that the Democratic Party did when Trump won. They wanted stuff like that and maybe a little bit beyond that to happen at the inauguration. And it didn't happen. And now they're disappointed. So, you know, was it Biden or Obama's chief of staff, Rahm Emanuel? He famously quoted as saying, never let a tragedy go to waste. And I guarantee the Democratic Party was hoping for that tragedy to happen today. Now, again, not saying they wanted somebody to get killed, but they would have loved some confrontation to happen today. They didn't get it.
Yeah, I have to admit that the one of the reasons I watched a little bit of it was because it was, for me, similar to watching a hockey game or a NASCAR race. Is I was just waiting for the crash. It never came. And then somebody else pointed out to me the only way Biden could get 10,000 people at his inauguration was to have the military there. So I'm like, that's probably pretty accurate. I don't know if you got to watch it at all, but former President Clinton did his best I'm falling asleep routine again, as did Obama. So you might get to see that at some point. I was going to hold off on this. Go ahead.
I have one question because I did not see it. Like I said, down here in the Conk Republic, we have a news blackout. But when Trump got sworn in and Ivanka and Melania came in and they have that famous or infamous video of Hillary and Bill standing next to each other. And Bill is clearly looking over towards Melania and Ivanka. And it looks like a fat kid that just sat down to the all-you-can-eat buffet. I'm telling you.
I remember.
He had a look on his face that you don't see kids on Christmas looking at the packages, you know, the Christmas presents, the way he was. And Hillary caught him. If you haven't seen that video, Google it.
It wasn't the first time he was caught.
Exactly. Well, yeah, in the grand scheme of things, that's for him, that's minor. But so at least he behaved better, because I'm hoping he wasn't looking at Dr. Jill Biden way he was looking at Melania.
See, now you just pushed my button. this is one of my pet peeves, is just because you have a PhD does not, in my book, entitle you to be called doctor. The only people I call doctor have MD after their name. It's just one of my pet peeves, and CNN and all the mainstream media now are are doing this, you know, President and Dr. Biden are making their way towards the podium, and it just drives me insane.
Well, you know why they're doing it, but I surprisingly, I'm going to part ways with you on this one. First of all, I guarantee you refer to Julius Erving as Dr. J.
Stop
Did you
it.
Not?
Stop it.
But I don't have a problem with this. I really don't. I have a problem with it the way they're using it. You know, especially was it Whoopi Goldberg who said she needs to become the Surgeon General because she's a great doctor. And you know, and this is why they're trying to position her. And she even said it. You can look up the quote, but she even said it. The reason she wanted it is because she got tired of being called, you know, it's Senator Joe Biden and, you know, the broad he's standing next to. And I put that in quotes as, you know, part of like kind of summing up what she was saying and the reason she went for her doctorate. So they're using it as a way to make her sound like a medical doctor, to make her sound more qualified than that she is. Now, with that said, I think anybody that acquires a doctorate in, I don't care if it's in English or, you know, women's studies, music, whatever, because it's a rigorous process to get a doctorate, and you've earned it. So I have no problem with somebody using that title. I have a couple family members who are pharmacists. Technically they're doctors. If you look at their degrees, but they don't use it at all. Attorneys, I think, get a doctor of jurisprudence, and they don't use it. So I understand your point, but if somebody's earned it and they want to use it, I don't have a problem with it. But again, it's how the media is using it to pump her up and to make her look bigger. And did you see, this is totally a sideways step, but did you see the media coverage on how Dr. Jill Biden is bringing fashion back
American
to the first
fashion.
Lady position?
American
what?
Fashion.
What? Yeah. Melania Trump was a model. And look, all things aside, I certainly don't want to, you know, I think she's such an accomplished person. I hate to even speak in these terms because I don't want to bring her down to just this level. But Melania Trump is a stunning woman, period. End of story. She's a stunning, attractive woman. You could put her in a burlap sack and she's going to look stunning. But this just goes to show you how petty the media is and what, you know, what levels they'll go to pump up Dr. Jill Biden or, Queen Michelle and then on the other hand, just degrade Melania Trump. Just give us the facts. It's just insane. The pettiness it is.
Yeah. When they said that and I saw what she was wearing, I'm like, I'm pretty sure I saw that same thing at Kohl's last week.
on the sale rack.
Yeah. I flip around the news channels at night when I'm looking for show material, and I happened to turn on Tucker a couple nights ago, and he was playing a clip from the U.S. rep out of New York, Jamal Bowman. I don't know if you heard this, but this is something you need to take a listen to, and then Tucker goes off on one of his spiels. But at the end of it, I'm like, you know, that makes a lot of sense. And I almost started questioning if maybe the Democrats weren't doing this on purpose. This is about a minute and a half, so take a listen and we'll talk about it.
Here's Congressman Jamal Bowman explaining that the real problem with this country is white people. They're the threat to progress.
But this is a chance for all of us in Congress to sort of begin at a new baseline and stop spreading the myth of American exceptionalism and accept the fact that this is exactly who we are, and this is exactly who we've been throughout our country's history. Whenever there's social progress, there's white backlash.
The story here is not that one member of Congress said this on television. The story is that many members of Congress and members of our media say this on television every single day, attack huge groups of Americans on the basis of their skin color, and nobody says anything. Nobody pushes back, as if there are no consequences to talking that way. But there are. How long can people keep talking like that and keep acting like this, irresponsibly, crazily, before something breaks? before one of those 74 million hunted terrorist Trotskyite wreckers we keep hearing about becomes so overwrought and paranoid from watching demagogues like Jamal Bowman attack him on MSNBC that he does something truly awful that can't be taken back. And then the cycle accelerates radically, and an awful lot of people get hurt. That's where this is going. Everyone knows it. That's where this will go until and unless someone responsible within the Democratic Party appears and puts a stop to it, and soon. It's time for the victors to accept their victory, to forgive the team they beat, and to move on. You won. Be happy. Now improve the country you inherited.
I can't argue with the logic, and that's kind of where I was getting at before the break was, do you think that this is what maybe, you know, not official party lines, but this is what deep down in the deepest recesses of their mind they're hoping for? Is it, and I'm not going to lie, there are some people out there that I consider lunatics for Trump. Are they hoping that one of these lunatics gets pushed too far by hearing this over and over and over and finally goes off the edge and it does something crazy that, you know, you can't take back, hurts somebody, you know, does something? What are we doing here?
This is exactly what I was talking about before when I said that the words that Trump spoke, while wrong and antagonistic in nature, didn't do near the damage to this country and cause radicalism as much as quotes like you just played or Tucker Carlson just played on his show. That's exactly what it does. And not only does that type of rhetoric fire up the people who are on the same side, it fires up the people who are on the opposite side, because they go, look, see what they think of us. See what they think of us. I mean, here's another quote from Bowman. Why was a fascist, because that word or another word that ends in ist, you know, pick whichever one you want, but that has to be in every comment issued from any member of the Democratic Party. But why was a fascist white supremacist mob able to overwhelm Capitol Police? Do ties exist between the white supremacist who launched that attack and members of the police force? So you've got members of Congress accusing the Capitol Police of being in cahoots with somebody doing what they call a coup. Then you've got them accusing colleagues on the other side of the aisle of being involved in a coup. You got the media saying they were involved in a coup. How much more stirring does the pot need before somebody on one end of the radical spectrum goes off the deep end? It's going to get worse before it gets better. And until I'm a big believer in self-responsibility. When we spoke last week about the Capitol, the protest at the Capitol, I said, look, I don't care what Trump said. I don't care what Maxine Waters said. If I was in that group, I would not have broke into the Capitol. I would not have gone and stolen Nancy Pelosi's laptop, and I wouldn't have taken the podium from the speaker. People did that. Those people did that. Trump didn't make them do it. Maxine Waters didn't make them do it. Nancy Pelosi didn't make them do it. Those people made decisions to do that. So we need that degree of personal responsibility where if I do something really stupid, whether it's burning down a Target, breaking into the Capitol, or shooting somebody, I have to pay the price for that. And we have to, as a society, agree that it's all wrong. One of the first things I said after the January 6th event at the Capitol was I condemn it. And I also said, if you didn't condemn what happened over the summer, then you have no right to condemn this, because you got to be consistent. If violence is bad, violence is bad. If an event is bad, it's bad. Don't look at it and say, well, it benefits me. No, if something's wrong, it's wrong. And I've said it before. We got to stop thinking right and left. We got to start thinking right and wrong. And until we get there, we're in a world of hurt.
It is definitely strange times we live in, that's for sure. And I hope that nobody goes crazy, nothing bad happens. And I'm going to tell you right now, I, from the deep inside me, I sincerely hope that Biden is successful, that the Democrats are successful, that my deferred comp stays successful. I hope that he can do the things that I truly believe he thinks he can do, because I'm not too sure his thinking is based in reality or in this world altogether. But I really hope and wish him success in the next 18 months while he's in office. So that being said, I know, you know, since you're down there in the sunshine, you pretty much do nothing other than scour social media. what are you finding? What's the trending posts, or what are not the trending posts?
Well, one thing I would say to you on wishing the president well, I always find that statement kind of curious, because I don't mean to get into semantics, but words do mean things. When somebody says they wish the president well, you can do that without wishing his policies well. In other words, if Biden came in and he enacted policies that I don't care for, but unemployment stayed low, wages were solid, my 401k was doing well, stock market was still doing well, okay, that's the president doing well. But I don't want him to come in and the president do well in enacting all of his policies and then the country go down the toilet. So when you say generically, I want the president to do well and I wish him well, that's a nice sentiment and everything. But we've got to be careful about what we're really saying when we offer that. And I know, again, I'm kind of reading between the lines a little bit. But, you know, I don't wish Joe Biden poorly. I wish the country well. And if he guides us in a direction that makes the country do well, fine. If he goes in an opposite direction, I don't want him to do well, because I don't want him to be successful putting in policies that make the country do bad things. But as you mentioned, I was scouring, because I have no life, I was scouring social media and looking for some opinions from people saying, go Biden. Yay, I'm so glad to have Joe Biden as my president. And the funny thing was, I had multiple memories pop up on Facebook of my posts of, you know, hope Trump does well, that the country does well. I looked at some other people's feeds when, you know, Trump took over. A lot of the Trump supporters were excited that Trump was now president, and they were looking forward to his policies. I had to look long and hard to find anybody that was pro Biden saying, yes, we're so excited that Biden's in office. But this is more the type of stuff that I found. Now, you can sing this one with me if you want. Hit the road, Don, and don't you come back no more, no more, no more. Hit the road, Don, and don't you come back no more. That was one post that was apparently supporting Joe Biden become president of the United States. Hey, you can take all your Trump stuff down now. Exhilarating to watch the new president take the office. And I thought the Kraken was going to be released. Drain the swamp. He pardoned Bannon. He robbed millions of publicans and gave it to him. No refunds now. Ha 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 ha. I don't even know what that means. This just in. We are not, I repeat, not going to see an amazing new health care plan. This is all stuff when Biden was about to be sworn in. And again, I could fill up a whole nother hour of show of pulling out comments that supported the fact that Trump was no longer president and how gleeful they were over his demise. I mean, isn't that a bit of a sick person? And again, I don't mean to be over dramatic, but isn't that a bit of a sick person? When you take, I mean, look, I was happy Hillary Clinton lost, but I was more happy that President Trump won. Isn't it a little sick to be really excited about somebody else's demise? I don't know. We need to really start looking at ourselves.
Oh, yeah, you are correct. So for some reason, I am on this TikTok kick, and there were so many showing Marine One and an Air Force One, people using profanity, get out of here. Yeah, not Biden's my man. It was always we hate Trump. Hey, guess what? That's going to do it for another exciting, jaw-dropping episode of the Halls of Justice. Don't forget to find us on the Facebook at Halls of Justice, and you can also send us an email, and the announcer guy is going to tell you how to do that in just a couple of seconds. We'll see you next week. Thanks to our co-host, the Fat Man, down in Key West, having a blast. We'll see you next week, everybody, on the Halls of Justice.
You've been listening to the Halls of Justice. Be sure to like, share, and subscribe. If you have a show idea, would like to be a guest, or just want to communicate with a show, email us at hallsofjustice@roadrunner.com. You can also find us on Facebook. Tell all your friends. And we'll see you for a new episode next week of the Halls of Justice.